Good afternoon, and welcome to the Spartanburg County Foundation's Investment Performance Webinar. I'm Vic Bailey, a trustee of the Spartanburg County Foundation and also chairman of the Finance Committee. Joining me on this webinar is Troy Hanna, president and CEO of the Spartanburg County Foundation. Later, you'll hear from Rick Morrison, principal and director of investment strategy, and Ian McPherson, principal with outsourced chief investment officer, Prime Buchholz and Associates. During today's webinar, we will discuss the Foundation's 2023 investment performance, the first quarter 2024 investment performance, and the 2024 outlook. The objectives for today's investment performance webinar are to provide transparency regarding the Foundation's investment management performance. The Foundation openly communicates our investment performance and the means by which we manage the philanthropic assets of the Foundation. We seek to offer the highest possible return to the philanthropic assets we hold while reducing the relative volatility to the portfolio. We will highlight the Foundation's disciplined approach and commitment to its fiduciary responsibilities. We will share important ways you can participate in philanthropy in the Spartanburg community. Through our partnership with Prime Buchholz, we will demonstrate the Foundation's strategic approach to investing the charitable dollars entrusted to the Foundation. Taking our fiduciary responsibilities very seriously, the Foundation leverages the expertise of our Investment Advisory Committee, or IAC. This committee is comprised of 9 community volunteers who are well-versed in investments and investment strategies, and a seated Foundation trustee serves as chair. The committee is supported by the Spartanburg County Foundation's finance team and the team from Prime Buchholz. The Investment Advisory Committee convenes in Spartanburg on a quarterly basis to review the investment performance of the portfolios. The committee discusses market conditions and the overall market outlook to assess the need for any changes to the Foundation's investment policy. Taking recommendations from the Investment Advisory Committee, Finance Committee, and Board of Trustees, we adhere to a disciplined schedule of reviews. This schedule of reviews is the foundation of our due diligence efforts, helping to ensure proper management of the assets entrusted to the Spartanburg County Foundation. Every 6 years, we review our outsourced chief investment officer. We reviewed our Investment Advisory Committee charter in 2023. We reviewed our custodian in 2022 and will again in 2026. We review our investment policy statement, the guiding document for our outsourced chief investment officer, every year. Each year, we review our spending policy, spending rate, and rolling average.
Thank you, Vic. And thanks to our donors, fund holders, and nonprofits, and any others who may be watching. We are honored that you're joining us for this investment performance webinar. We would like to highlight the ways you may partner with the Foundation and be involved in philanthropy that makes a difference here in Spartanburg County. The Foundation is working to provide even more grants with a campaign to build the Community Impact Fund, the fund from which our trustees distribute grants to respond to community needs. Donors can make gifts of any size to the fund. The Foundation stays informed about community needs and can invest the pooled resources in this fund back into the community when and where they will be most helpful. A QR code is provided on the screen, or you may contact the Foundation for more information. In conjunction with refreshing our website, the Foundation has launched GoDonate, an online giving platform that makes it easy to become involved in philanthropy. Through this tool, you can learn more about funds the Foundation works to preserve, protect, and grow. You can see featured funds like our Community Impact Fund or the Just Because Fund seen here, or you can browse our new fund catalog. In the fund catalog, you may search by an area of interest, a category based upon the community indicators, civic health, economy, education, natural environment, public health, social environment, and cultural vitality, or search the catalog by the name of a fund or a keyword. You can even register on the portal to be recognized in the system when you want to make a new gift. Once you identify a fund or cause you'd like to support, you can read more about it and then donate securely from the fund's page. You can even register on the portal to see your gift history and to make it easier to enter future gifts. The work of the foundation would not be possible without you, our donors, fundholders, and philanthropic community. Because of your generosity at all levels, contributions to the foundation totaled $47.4 million in 2023. Throughout the year, we managed over 1,140 funds. The foundation, in partnership with our donors, awarded $686,000 in scholarships. A total of over $28.6 million was granted back into Spartanburg County throughout the year. As of December 31st, 2023, the foundation's total assets were $279 million. As we've done since 2021, our fund holders can choose to have all or portions of their funds invested in any of the three investment options we offer, depending upon their investment goals and risk tolerance. In 2023, the money market pool performed at a positive 4.98%. The moderate pool performed at a positive 13.3%. The growth pool performed at a positive 17.7%. We know that these positive returns will have a great impact on our community. Nonprofits who have funds invested with us will benefit from added resources and security. Individual fund holders will also have more resources from investment earnings to be able to provide more grants. Now, I'd like to turn our program over to Rick Morrison and Ian McPherson, who will share our investment performance results for 2023 and the first quarter of 2024, as well as their outlook for the remainder of the year.
So 2024 has been an interesting start to the capital markets. It is a lot more differentiated than 2023. You see those yellow bars, which was last year in the market, and there was positive performance coming from almost everywhere. Equity markets in the U.S. up over 25%, outside the U.S. up in the mid-teens. But there were positive results to be had in equities and bonds, in flexible capital, which is our terminology for hedge funds, and in the real asset category. 2024, a little bit different. So this is the blue bars. You can see they're not quite as tall as the yellow, as we're only about, you know, not quite halfway through the year at this point. But certainly there's also more differentiation. In fact, so far this year, it has really mattered how you've been positioned. Assets that are sensitive to a higher for longer interest rate regime and inflation that's been a little bit stickier have performed relatively well. Think about the real assets and equities within the portfolio. But those that are much more fragile in sort of higher inflationary environments or higher interest rate environments have had a difficult time so far in 2024, most acutely U.S. bonds. So it has certainly been different where everything rose last year. This year, positioning really has mattered. But all in all, the portfolio is off to a relatively good start. That being said, there are a variety of macro risks out there that we're keeping our eye on. And when we talked about this last year, some of these were the same risks that we were reviewing at that time. And, you know, one of them is inflation, this macroeconomic risk of, is this inflationary environment that we're in going to last longer than what many of the market are hoping it's what we're in? Will the monetary policy that's been put in place by the central bank here, the Federal Reserve, as well as overseas, you know, is there a risk of policy error associated with all of these unique and distinct monetary policies that we have across the globe? You know, we're still working through the potential of some banking stress, particularly for some of the regional banks. And this is primarily related to the real estate segment, and real estate has had a hard time finding a bottom. So while other asset classes have seemed to have hit their bottom after the bear market of 22 and started to recover, real estate is one of those that is having a harder time finding a bottom. And the knock-on effect of that is some sensitivity to the banking sector, particularly to regionals. And then, of course, there were just the general geopolitical tensions, things going on outside the U.S., particularly in the Middle East, in Eastern Europe. And then we also have, in addition to some of those geopolitical tensions, we also just have the geopolitical risk associated with elections happening all across the globe. We have ours here in November, but there are many election cycles going on, which just can add fragility to the market. So we're very comfortable that we have enough inflation protection in the portfolio that we've added recently, particularly in that real asset segment, that we think can help if that inflation environment does stay higher for longer. We like our flex cap portfolio to take advantage of if there is policy errors that leads to gapping markets. We think we're in a pretty good position to take care of that. Our cash is cash, you know, well protected within money market funds. These are not sensitive to a real regional banking stress that, like we saw in the spring a couple of years back. And, you know, we think we're well positioned with lots of liquidity in this portfolio to be able to opportunistically rebalance if we see the opportunity. So there are many risks out there, but we think we're well positioned to capture any volatility that comes along with those risks. And part of that is the idea of what the OCIO relationship is. So as many of you know, or many of you remember, we switched a couple of years ago from what is a traditional advisory relationship to an OCIO. And essentially what that means is that Ian and I, with our team here at Prime Buckles, can look at the portfolio daily and make trades as needed. And we think that's a real advantage to be able to do that, particularly in these volatile markets, because there is the ability to just make decisions and execute the portfolio, any changes in the portfolio on within a day or so, as opposed to working through this quarterly cycle with investment committees. So while the investment committee is really involved in setting risk parameters and guidelines and informing us of what the expectations are for the Spartanburg County Foundation, we are able to execute that on a daily basis without needing to go through the investment committee. Although we do meet with them down in Spartanburg quarterly and have a very good working relationship with that group. So far, so good. In 2024, you see the assets on the right-hand side. This is through the end of April. Assets went from $200 million at the start of the year to about $215 million as of where we were at the end of April. So very good results. You see that bar is yellow from the beginning of time up through the end of 2020, and then you start seeing yellow and blue from 2021 forward. That identifies the difference between the traditional pool, which was that Spartanburg County Foundation moderate pool, and the newly designated growth pool, which has a more aggressive risk profile than the moderate pool, but we'll talk a little bit about that later. But that's the difference in colors that you see for the last couple of years that wasn't there in those historical datas. But we are, again, nearing an all-time high from an asset standpoint sitting here in late spring, early summer of 2024. Portfolio positioning is in line with those risk targets and risk profile as defined by the investment committee and ultimately the board of the Spartanburg County Foundation. The top one, the traditional moderate pool, has global public equity of just under half the portfolio. About 45% is the target to public equity. The remaining 55% is allocated to more defensive areas like flexible capital, fixed income, real assets in cash, so 45% in equity and 55% in more defensive strategies. The growth pool on the bottom there has a target of more like 70% to public equity, another 10% to private equity, and the remainder is in those defensive categories of flexible capital, fixed income, real assets, and cash. The private equity target is going to take quite some time for us to get there. We have a 10% target there. our expectation in maybe 5, 6, 7 years before we actually get up to 10%. So we'll likely continue to hold a fair amount in public equity until that time. But the long-term projection here is to have a 10% allocation to private equity in the growth pool. And in a moment or so, we'll talk about how those different risk profiles and different portfolios have behaved from a performance standpoint on the next couple of slides.
Yeah, so I'll pick it up here and talk a little bit about performance. And as you see with the moderate pool, this has historically been the main pool for the foundation. Strong long-term returns going back all the way to April 1990, so almost 35 years. But with that asset allocation that Rick mentioned before, we're really expecting this to be, in the 6 to 7% total return. There's quite a bit of defensive assets. You can see as we range from 5 to 20 years, we've generally been in that, area or ballpark. How the growth pool differs, and you certainly see this in the last year with the more favorable risk backdrop, more favorable backdrop for equities, is a little bit more upside, a little bit more volatility. So we look at that one-year experience. The growth pool is up actually 19%, just a really strong performer. Whereas the moderate pool, a bit more hedged, only up under 14%, not only, but, modestly less than the growth pool. So we think that really illustrates that dynamic. And we'll talk a little bit about, positioning in that going forward. But as we think about this growth pool long-term, we think there's about 1% or so extra return over and above the moderate pool. And that results largely from the differing asset allocations, the growth pool designed for donors that want to be a little bit more aggressive with their capital, more in equities, hopefully cover spending, inflation, and a little bit of growth over time. On the other hand, the moderate pool really only expected to cover spending plus inflation. We do have close to approaching 3 years in the growth pool, and it's up about 4% annualized. So a little bit of the downside in 21, 22, roaring back quite strongly, though, in the strong markets in 23 and 24. As we look at liquidity, both structures very liquid right now. So if we look at the moderate pool, 67% in daily traded vehicles, growth pool at 83%. The difference here over time will be the build-out of a private equity program in the growth pool. And that's something we're pretty excited about as we work with clients and look at the top performing endowments foundations out there. They're very meaningfully involved in private equity, and it takes time to get to a target allocation, but we're making strides in getting there. To date, we've made about $2 million in commitments in the growth pool. Those commitments will draw down over the next 3 to 4 years, and we'll continue to look for opportunities there. So over time, our expectation is that the illiquid piece of the growth pool will grow at the expense of the daily liquid piece of the growth pool. But the takeaway here today, both structures, very liquid, very flexible, and afford us quite a bit of latitude if we need to rebalance and should risk dynamics change. So just to get a little bit more into the growth pool, we've been really pleased with the progress, the build out of the portfolio. It seems to be getting some traction, funded with little shy of 14 million. And then we see the subsequent add 7 million in 2021, 11 million in 2022, and a million in 2024 so far. So an end balance at 37 million. So nice to have a few million dollars of growth out of the gate. Again, really pleased with the traction this has been getting and the uptake from the donor side of things. And again, over the long term, we really believe that this pool can compound at a higher level, and that private equity will be a major differentiator. As Rick also alluded to, it will take some time to get to that 10% private equity target. We're thinking possibly 3 to 5 years. But again, we've made strides. We've made a little over 2 million in commitments, one recently. So I think we're on pace to eventually get to our target. We put this slide together during the leaner years in 21 and 22, where the growth portfolio was newer. And our take at that time was that, this may be a nice time for donors that want a little bit more growth for the long term to start to dollar cost average into the to the growth pool. And I think those donors that did do that are starting to really see the results, really noticeable in that 1 year time period, up about 5 points higher, 18.2 versus 13.1 for the moderate. So, with markets where that were beaten down by inflationary dynamics, Fed's tightening regime, it feels like we're on the other end of that, and it could be a more constructive backdrop for risk assets. So our belief again was that the growth pool could be it could be an opportune time rather to look at the growth pool and to consider an allocation. We have segment performance, a lot of numbers on the page, but we've been really pleased with the returns. We look at that 1 year time period, moderate pool, we consider to be fairly low risk, up under 14%. The big driver has been the public equity portfolio, up 23%. As we look at other drivers, we did reposition the flexible capital hedge fund portfolio, starting to see some early signs of returns there, up 13%. We've gotten some nice relative returns from our real assets portfolio, and that's been an area we've been leaning in as inflation has remained entrenched and strong through a multi-asset vehicle, which provides exposure to resources, infrastructure, and real estate, up 2.7 in the 1 year, but really showing some signs of strength this year as a lot of those categories have started to perform better. We'll look at a similar dynamic on the growth pool, up 19.1 in the trailing 1 year. So again, capturing more of that equity market upside. Similarly, global public equity have been the driver here, up close to 24%. A little bit different construction on our flexible capital. You may recall there's more daily liquidity in the growth pool, so we're still implementing our hedge fund portfolio through daily liquid funds with tickers. So we've had a little bit softer performance there. Also a little bit more in our real assets bucket in that strategy that I mentioned before. So slightly different construction, but generally speaking, a lot of similarities across the lineup. Haven't seen a lot of returns yet out of the private equity, having it being so new, but our expectation is as we get through the year, we get a bit more seasoning, we'll start to see some returns accumulate to that segment as well. So I think that's all we have for our update today. I know we've covered a lot of ground. Rick highlighted the macro risks that are out there. First and foremost, we think it's the Fed navigating their unwind of this fairly tight regime we've been through over the past couple of years. We think that's a key market risk, one we feel well positioned to take advantage of, along with a host of other risks should they start to materialize. And we feel really strongly about how the portfolios are positioned right now. We look forward to continuing to build out the private equity portfolio in the growth pool. And again, I'm pleased and we'll continue to work hard on behalf of donors. So we'll see you next year.
Thank you.
I would like to thank Rick and Ian for joining us today and providing us with a very informative overview of the Foundation's investment performance. We also thank you, our donors and fundholders, for viewing this webinar. Please feel free to share this information with your boards, colleagues, and other interested parties. Troy, do you have any closing remarks?
Yes, thank you, Vic. The Foundation takes its role as a philanthropic fiduciary very seriously to allow fundholders to have the greatest community impact. It is in this context that we at the Spartanburg County Foundation are dedicated to a disciplined approach around investment strategy. We are committed to transparency and communication with our fundholders to promote this critical work. We thank you and we are grateful. This concludes the investment performance webinar. Thank you for watching.